Welcome to Wareham Town Museum. The museum tells the story of the town through the ages. There has been a small museum in Wareham since the early 1960s, when Harry Broughton opened a private museum in his house in North Street. In 1974, Wareham Town Council acquired the collection and established a museum in St John's Hill. 10 years later, it moved to its present site adjacent to the town hall. Like many small museums, we have a very varied collection and we use it to illustrate the history of the town and the surrounding area. Wareham dates back to Saxon times, when it was one of the most important towns in the Saxon Kingdom of Wessex. Today it is a small market town serving a wide area, including the Isle of Purbeck to the south of the town. The museum is run by volunteers.
Good morning.
And some of them will now share with you a few of the treasures in the museum. Our story begins millions of years ago in the time of the dinosaurs.
Wareham in Purbeck is known as the gateway to the Jurassic coast. The Jurassic period began 200 million years ago and lasted for about 55 million years. During the Jurassic period, dinosaurs dominated the land. Dinosaur footprints and trails have been found in many of the stone quarries in the Purbeck area. We're lucky to have a dinosaur footprint in the museum. This has been identified as the footprint of a juvenile iguanodon. Iguanodon could grow to over 10 meters in length. It was a vegetarian. It could also run on two or four legs. A notable feature of the iguanodon was its thumb spike. This might have been used for fighting. It was also thought that iguanodons lived in herds like elephants. This chart shows where the Jurassic period fits into the timeline. This is when our iguanodon would have lived.
The oldest man-made object on display is this hand axe, which is between 60 and 100,000 years old. It is made of flint and would have been handheld. It was a general purpose cutting and chopping tool. We now move forward to our collection of objects made from shale, which date from about 2,000 years ago.
Kimmeridge shale is a rock which is found in outcrops around Kimmeridge Bay in Dorset. It's a very soft rock and it's easy to carve, and as such it's been used since deep prehistory to make personal ornaments such as beads, vessels and bracelets such as this one. Now, during the Iron Age and the Roman era, these bracelets began to be made in vast quantities. Initially they were made by hand using a chisel, an iron chisel, and this is an example of one that was handmade. As you can see, it's been roughed out into a rough circle. You can see the chisel facets in here. But this one was abandoned in production because it has a big crack here. And so had they finished making it, it wouldn't have stayed in one piece. And so they abandoned it. During the late Iron Age, they began to use new technology to make shale objects. They began to use a lathe, probably like this replica pole lathe here. This in itself has an interesting history. It was used by Channel 4's Time Team when they investigated a Romano-British site on Green Island and Poole Harbour. When they began to use the new lathe technology, they also began to use new tools. And this is an example of a sawn rough-out ready for a bracelet. You can see the saw marks all the way around the edge. But again, this has been abandoned in production. It's probably because it's laminated on this face, and so it wouldn't have made a good bracelet. During the Iron Age, they used a square fixing to fix the shale to the lathe, and this square hole here indicates that this is an Iron Age lathe core. Later on, during the Roman period, they began to use pegs to fix the shale to the lathe, and this example has two peg holes this side. This is a very interesting example, as a matter of fact, because this is the waste core with the bracelet still attached. Now, this was broken again in production, and it must have been very frustrating for the artisan who was making it, because it's almost finished, as you can see. It was almost detached from the lathe core, and it's broken at the last moment. It's interesting and something of a mystery that shell ornaments seem to just go completely out of fashion after the Romans left. You never find them in Dark Age or Saxon contexts. That was the end of the shell industry in Britain.
During Roman times, there was a small settlement on the site of Wareham. Some of the inhabitants were making pottery, and here we have an example of a jar which was made in the potteries in the area. Kilns like this have been found during archaeological excavations at Bestwell, east of the town.
Wareham is famous for its Saxon walls, which are the best preserved Saxon town defences in England. Over 1,000 years ago, Danish Vikings attempted to conquer England. At the time, England was divided into a series of separate kingdoms. Wareham was in the Kingdom of Wessex. The Danes succeeded in conquering the rest of England, and in the 870s they attempted to conquer Wessex, which at the time was ruled by King Alfred. In anticipation of Viking attacks, many of the towns in Wessex were provided with defences, and Wareham, being an important town, still has banks and ditches on three sides, and the fourth side was the river. As you can see, today the walls are grassy ramparts, but originally there would have been a deep ditch and the rampart would have had a timber palisade along the top. At a later date, probably in the late 900s, a stone wall was built along the top, making the defences truly formidable. At some later date still, the stone wall was removed, probably to build the town of Wareham. And all we have now is grassy ramparts. This section of West Walls is traditionally known as Bloody Bank, after various hangings that have taken place here. The first one was in 1213, when a hermit known as Peter de Pomfret was hung here for daring to prophesy that King John's rule would come to an end. And the second occasion was in 1685, when five men were hung here for daring to take part in the Monmouth Rebellion. Today, the walls form a very pleasant walk around Wareham, and there are information boards along the route.
Here in the museum, you can see objects dating from the time when Wareham was an important Saxon town. These silver pennies were actually minted in the town. This picture shows both sides of a penny which was minted during the reign of King Ethelred, between 978 and 1016. We also have a display about the remarkable sword which was found in the bed of the River Frome at Wareham. It dates to the late 10th century, and an inscription on its handle shows that it belonged to a member of the royal family of Wessex.
The Fire of Wareham started on Sunday the 25th of July 1762. This map shows how the fire spread through the town. The fire started on the site of the Bull's Head Inn, which is now the location of Lloyd's Bank in South Street. A chambermaid is thought to have carelessly emptied some hot ashes at the back of the premises. This caused some dry wood lying there to catch fire. It quickly spread due to high winds, especially along North Street at the site of the shambles. Most of the townfolk were in church at the time, so as soon as they knew the fire was spreading, hurried to their properties to get their belongings. This included the wife of the Reverend Hutchins, who grabbed her husband's manuscripts, and they all waded into the river to escape the fire. By 7 p.m, the fire had virtually burnt itself out due to a change in wind direction. However, as you can see from the map, almost a third of the town was destroyed. An interesting feature of our fire display is our fire insurance plaques. These would have been attached to the front of a person's building to show that they had paid for their fire insurance, as there was no public fire service at this time. You'll see many of these examples around the town.
One of the lesser known industries of Purbeck is clay mining. Purbeck clay was highly prized for making fine white china from the 17th century onwards. Most of the clay was exported, but at Sandford, near Wareham, it was used by several potteries, as we will now see.
The 1850s saw the beginning of Sandford as an industrial centre. In 1849, the Victoria Works opened, making bricks, which was established by wealthy philanthropist Lady Burdett Coutts to provide work for the labourers in the village. 7 years later, work began on the huge factory with its landmark chimney, known as Sandford Pottery. In the early days, it made fine art pottery, but later more mundane objects such as brick, chimney pots and tiles. It closed in 1966 and the chimney was demolished in 1979. The next pottery was the Kearsworth Pottery, which was established in a brickyard by another woman, Amy Baker, in 1910. It produced bricks and fine artware, but closed in 1930. The final pottery to be established in Sandford was the Sibley Pottery, which produced this beautiful clear blue pottery and opened about 1920. Lawrence of Arabia commissioned a black tea service to be made and sent to a friend in the desert. The edges of the plates curved inwards to stop the sand getting into the food. He later ordered another one to be made for himself, and Thomas Hardy's wife admired it so much that she too had one made. The pottery closed in 1939, but the original building as seen here is still in existence, and the kiln, and both are listed, but sadly not open to the public.
During the First World War, Wareham was transformed by the huge military camp built on the outskirts of the town. The camp accommodated up to 7,000 troops who were trained in trench warfare before heading for the front. Some of this training even took place within the town, including bridge building on the River Frome. Columns of marching soldiers were a common sight in the town. Another big development in the Wareham area during the First World War was the building of a huge factory making cordite at Holton Heath. Cordite was an explosive material used in guns, similar to gunpowder. The factory employed thousands of workers from the local area and from Poole. Many of the workers were women because most men were away in the army. T.E. Lawrence, Lawrence of Arabia, has important connections with Wareham. When he returned to England in the 1920s from organising the Arab revolt against the Turkish Ottoman Empire, he took up residence at Clouds Hill, a small cottage near the Bovington Army Camp in Dorset, and frequently visited Wareham on his Brough Superior motorcycle. This picture shows such a motorcycle, thought to be Lawrence's, parked outside the Red Lion Hotel in the centre of town. Wareham Museum has this and many other pictures connected with T.E. Lawrence on display, together with a poster advertising David Lean's award-winning 1962 film, Lawrence of Arabia. Lawrence was born in Wales in 1888 and moved to Oxford, where he later studied at Oxford University and worked as an archaeologist in the Middle East. At the outbreak of the First World War, he was recruited to head British military intelligence in Egypt. He served in both the Tank Corps and the RAF, and during his career also used the names J.H. Ross and T.E. Shaw. In 1935, At the age of 46, Lawrence was killed in a motorcycle accident at this spot near Bovington, in circumstances which are to this day unclear. He was buried at Morton, near Wool. Later, a life-size effigy of Lawrence was created by Eric Kennington, which can be seen in St. Martin's Church, Wareham.
Within our toy case, we have a number of toys. One of them is this doll. She is a German doll by the company Armand Marseille. She was given to my grandmother in 1910 when a local German that was working on a farm found out that her father had been killed. So he sent back to Germany to his family and asked them to send over a doll. This is the one that arrived, and she is not for the British market as she has brown hair and brown eyes as opposed to blue, which was normally this colour sent for the British market. The other doll we have is an English rosebud doll. Her name is Mary. She was given to my mother in 1948. She's actually a crying doll, so if she behaves herself and we can get it right, she will cry. So we'll give it a try. So we tilt her backwards and we tilt her forwards and hopefully she'll cry. She's in rather a poor condition. Unfortunately, my uncle used to like to make her do handstands on a flagstone floor. The other item that we have is the traction engine. This is made entirely from rubbish by a chap called Tony Wellstead. The main body of it is a coffee can. The wheel hubs are actually cut from talcum powder tins when talcum powder came in tins. It's fitted with fairy lights and does actually work. It's part of a large collection of fairground rides that Mr. Wellstead made, including a galloper that was over 6 foot across. Tony Wellstead actually has a memorial plaque in Wareham. It notes the place where he used to play his barrel organ and actually raised thousands of pounds for charity. During the Victorian era, the only toys you could play with on a Sunday had to have a religious story behind them. So items like the Noah's Ark would have been a toy that you could play with. You would not have been able to play with things like dolls, board games, any other type of toy. This one happens to be from the 1920s, but it still holds the same stories behind it.
That brings an end to our presentation, and we hope that you have enjoyed it. Please take the opportunity to look round the museum and find many more things that are on display than have been mentioned in this film. We are a volunteer-run museum and make no entrance charge. However, if you have enjoyed what you have seen, we'd be very happy to accept a small donation, which you may leave in the box by the entrance. Thank you very much for visiting.